no one else could see, but something was done.
Even if, let's say, you converted it to a family room, wouldn't you really have to put a camera in there anyway?
In a classroom, right?
I think they have for, in all the kids' things.
There you go.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, yes, that would be, that would solve.
And then, I don't know, I did have ideas, because I just thought, but for, you know.
Entry, yeah, that's what my mom.
I think that's like.
When my mom visited, she said, the biggest thing is right there as you walk in, because that's your very first impression.
Let's have a look at it.
Yeah. Okay, you want to answer?
Yes. That'd be terrible.
You got to answer.
Yes. I have problems.
Emma, this reminds me of Pastor Scott's story of you falling down the stairs. And you made it out.
And I made it up.
She fell down the stairs.
You do, I said, I fell down 20 steps. And he always not a scratch.
Thank you. Thank you. good morning, everybody, and welcome to Grace Evangelical Free Church. Whether you're here physically with us in the church or if you're watching remotely via YouTube, it is an honor and privilege to have you with us this morning. Let's rise and worship our Lord and Savior and sing about how great He is. The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. And trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God! And all will see how great is our God! Age to age he stands, and time is in his hands. Beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God! And all will see how great is our God! Name above all praise, my heart will sing, how great is our God. Name above all names, worthy of all praise, my heart will sing, how great our God. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God! And all will see how great is our God! How great me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The Word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. By life freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is here. The hand that healed nations stretched out on a tree and took the nails for me. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. The grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he arose over death he had conquered. Now is ascended, my Lord, evermore. Death could not hold him, the grave could not keep him from rising again. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. Trumpet will sound for his coming. One day the skies with his glories will shine. Wonderful day, my beloved one springing. My Savior Jesus is mine. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day, glorious day, oh glorious day. Thank you. Please be seated. As we go into a time of offering.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Grace Church. As we go to our time of offering, I'd like to pray for offering and invite our ushers forward. If you're at home, thank you so much for your support in supporting Grace Church, even when you're at home and COVID and quarantine. And if you look at the link above me, that is a church website. If you want to know how to give, you can just scroll to the bottom and hit the give button. And thank you again for your support. Father God, we thank you for this offering. We thank you for your love and your grace. We thank you, Father, for, Lord, that you've loved us first. So, Lord, we just take this time of offering that you would use it and magnify it for your kingdom. In your name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. A couple questions real quick. When it comes to fellowship and being here at Grace Church, it's interesting. I see you guys this morning. We're like 42 strong this morning. And I could sit there and say, good morning, Melanie. Good morning, Keisha, Carla. Good morning, John. Hey, Aaron. Good morning, Aaron. How are you? And so I got fellowship here in this room. But I could say good morning to you guys on YouTube and at home. And you probably said good morning. A couple of you did. I think Mr. Daniel said good morning, Chuck. But if you can use that chat box, during the service, just to talk to each other. That's your time of fellowship as well. So really just to jump in, ask questions. I know that Pastor Rich will be engaging with you guys throughout the week, so to make sure that you guys can be brought into this room as well as we are separated, trying to make the most out of our COVID situation. Also, the Easter services that are coming up, we have Palm Sunday, Good Friday, and Easter, and we'd love to put together a choir. So if you think you'd like to sing, thought about it in the past, already actively singing, it doesn't matter. You need to look at this email above and send an email to Heidi. So Heidi Joy is coordinating the choir, and we're going to see what we can do, whether we get families together, groups together, individuals, it doesn't matter. You could be the Armstrong Five, right? Or you could be the Cassell crew, whatever they are. We could be the Lanús in One Direction because they're going to heaven, so they're only going one way. So whatever it is to be in this choir to get involved, just contact Heidi. Please don't think I could never do this because I'm really nervous, because Amanda shared with us how super nervous she is, but she's going to do it anyway. Thank you, Amanda. So this is our time of worship and our time of getting together. She's going to be praying a little while, so hopefully she will forgive me. So just take this time out to consider joining our choir. Again, you can reach out to Heidi. If you don't get the email, you can reach out to me, and I'll direct you to Heidi if that's the case. So we really want to see a big turnout for these three services that are coming up. And we know with COVID and restrictions, we're trying to format that. That's why we're doing three different services. We may have three different choirs if enough of you sign up. So we'd love to have you guys join our crew and worship the Lord, our Savior, during this Easter season.
Would you please rise as we continue our worship?
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of Thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for Thee. Swift and beautiful for Thee. And let me sing, always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from Thee. Filled with messages from Thee. Take my silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold. Take my intellect and use every power as Thou shalt choose. Every power as Thou shalt choose. Take my will. Shall be no longer mine. Take my heart, it is Thine own. It shall be Thy royal throne. It shall be Thy royal throne. Take my love, my Lord.
Good morning. Before I go into a time of prayer with you all, I wanted to share two big highs from this week. I was thinking about it during the songs and I was getting a little worked up, so. But on my way to work on Monday, I was thinking about a coworker who we have this bond with Jesus. And I went to him in the morning and I was sharing about Pastor Rich's sermon and I shared the link and he was there and he's like, I could tell he was getting teary-eyed and he's like, I needed to hear this and he's like getting chills. And it was a really awesome moment. And then a funny thing happened after, but that's besides the point. Some of you were in on that joke. And then the next day I was talking to a coworker walking in and she was talking to me about her father and how he's not doing that well. And I wish I had something to like give her comfort. And when I came out of the bathroom, there she was at the copier. And I was like, you go to church, right? And she was like, yeah. And then I started getting teary-eyed then. And I was like, can I share the link with you from church? I was talking about it. And then she gave me a hug and it was really awesome. So my point is, it can be scary to share, like to share. I don't know if anybody feels that way ever, like it's scary to open up, but it was really beautiful this week. So like we all have courage with God. So just like if you feel nervous, it's not God making you feel nervous to share his word. So just keep that in mind. Okay, so let's pray. Lord, we come to you today with thanks and praise. You are so, so good to us. You have given us a gift that the world could never provide us. You have given us salvation through the death and resurrection of your Son. You have given us your grace. You've promised us eternal life. And we can live out each of our days knowing that you are at the finish line. We thank you. When we compare ourselves to who we were before we knew you and who we are now that we're in relationship with you, we can see that we are lacking nothing. We're saved. Please help us to recognize you and your goodness. Please help us to gain your wisdom and understanding as we read your word. And give us the courage to step out of our comfort zones and share the gospel and glorify your name. Christ, you are in control. Please help us to remember and recognize that each day. Help us to be humble, putting you first in all that we do. It's hard, Lord. I really know that to be true, but please assist us all. Forgive us for the times that we compare ourselves to the world and lose sight of how blessed we are in your name. We must stay strong in our commitment to your word, and we must also stay strong in our commitment to our loving brothers and sisters. Thank you for our church, our leadership, our small groups, and our community. I see the unity growing at Grace, the new friendships forming, and people opening up to one another. We are so blessed. Thank you for shining your love and light on us always, and thank you for the wisdom that we are gaining, which allows us to recognize it more often. You are our one and only God. You are our Father, our Creator. We love you, and we lift our thanks and praise and our prayers up to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
All the room was hushed and still. What I'm asking you to do, this is what I'm kneeling here beside you. This is what I want my church to be. This is what I want the world to see. Who it is you follow. Love each other, one another. Love
love each other in the way that I have loved you. Walk together, and whatever comes, love each other in the way that I have loved you. In the way that I have loved you, walk together, and whatever comes, love each other. In the way that I have loved you, love each other, one another, love each other. In the way that I have loved you, walk together, and whatever comes, love each other in the way that I have loved you.
Thank you. Please be seated.
Good morning, everybody. I'd just like to say a short blessing for all of our kids. In Mark 10, 13 through 16, it says, "People were bringing little children to Jesus for him to place his hands on them. But the disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant. He said to them, 'Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. Truly, I tell you, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it.' And he took the children in his arms, placed his hands on them, and blessed them." Jesus, we just thank you so much for these precious little children. We thank you, Lord, for your love for them and for reminding us how important they are to you and how much you want us to be like them. We thank you, Lord, that you don't care if it's the right time or the right place, that you want them to come to you no matter what, whether it feels inconvenient, whether it feels awkward, whether they're wiggling in their pews and just, you know, bouncing their legs back and forth, or whatever, Lord, that you are watching over them and that you love them just as they are, right where they are. Amen. All right, have you guys ever been to a carnival? And there's these big walls with all these stuffed animal prizes, and you're like, oh, I want that one, or I want that one. It's like, well, you want them, but what do you have to do to get them? Like, you can't just, you know, ask for it. You have to, like, throw rings onto a bottle, or you have to shoot a little toy duck, or you have to knock down a bunch of bowling pins. You have to do something to earn it. You can't just get this for free, right? But sometimes we come along to the fair with a grown-up, and that grown-up knocks down the bottles for us, or throws the ring around the pins for us, or shoots that duck for us and gives us the prize, right? We didn't do anything to get it, but we still got the benefit because of who we were with. And today we're going to learn about a time when Jesus shared with his followers what it means to just get a gift for free like that. So I'll see you in Kids Church. Bye.
Hang on a sec, sorry. Microphone pack just slipped. This is embarrassing. Okay, good morning. Good morning, Grace family here in the room and also Grace family at home. I think this might be on. How are we? We good to go? Okay. Have you ever had someone say something to you that they hadn't really thought through how it would sound, and when you hear it, you don't know whether to laugh or cry? It could be a little deflating. I've had several of these over the course of time. This was one of them I was remembering about 10 years ago when I think I looked a lot younger than I do right now. I was standing out in the lobby of my church, and a young woman standing next to me turned and looked at me, and she said, "What color was your hair?" One time I was showing a colleague pictures of my children, and she said, "Oh, what good-looking children. You must have a beautiful wife." I don't know. this goes way back. When I was a teacher in the classroom, I remember instructing a young girl in what she was working on in her workspace, and she was just like fully engaged with everything I was explaining. And I was thinking, I am really good at this. And when I finished, I said, "Do you have any questions?" And she said, "Yes, did you wear braces when you were a kid?" anyway, these were just a few funny things I remember, but really in life, truthfully, often things are said to us that aren't funny. They can be hurtful or discouraging or just put us down. And because of that, Heidi and I, we spend a lot of our days when we pray together, we start it by saying, "God, help us to speak life today. Help us to speak words of encouragement into other people. Help us build other people up, not just our words, but our actions." We want to be all about trying to encourage and lift up the people around us. And that's what we all want to be doing when we call ourselves followers of Christ, is to be lifting up the people around us. And the passage that we're going to look at in Philippians today has a couple of examples of relationships that are just like that, that really were encouraging, healthy, building up of each other kinds of relationships. And I'm very excited to be able to share some thoughts on this part of Philippians today, because so much of what we look at and what we have looked at about what the Bible says about relationships is how to fix them when they're broken, how to reconcile, how to repair, how to love each other, how to forgive. And this is all true and necessary. But today we're actually going to see an example of a couple of relationships that were really good and healthy. We're in Philippians, still chapter 2. So if you'd flip your Bible to Philippians 2, if you grabbed one of the church Bibles that's been provided, I'm going to tell you what page I'm on as soon as I find it. I'm on page 952. If you have your own Bible from home, flip to Philippians chapter 2. I'm going to start in verse 19. I'll give you a second to get there, and then we'll read it. And I'll share a couple thoughts about the relationships that are shared in this passage. All right, here we go. Philippians chapter 2, verse 19, Paul writes, "I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon, that I also may be cheered when I receive news about you. I have no one else like him who will show genuine concern for your welfare, for everyone looks out for their own interests, not to those of Jesus Christ. But you know that Timothy has proved himself, because as a son with his father, he has served with me in the work of the gospel. I hope, therefore, to send him as soon as I see how things go with me, and I'm confident in the Lord that I myself will come soon." Now, I want to just stop right there. We're going to read more, but I want to stop there because I don't want us to miss something that's really important in this, and that's the relationship between Paul and Timothy. Timothy's not part of the Philippian church. Timothy is with Paul. And Paul really wants to come and visit the Philippian church, but as you may remember, Paul's in prison. He's in house prison, and he can't come. And he doesn't know how long he's going to be in prison, but he really wants to send someone to the Philippian church to encourage them, to represent him. And the best person Paul can think of to send to them is Timothy. So what Paul is saying here is, "I'm not sure when I can come, but I want to send Timothy." And his relationship with Timothy was very special. Paul met Timothy as a young man. Timothy was a young man, a younger man. And Paul must have seen something in Timothy that made him want to spend time with him, because he took Timothy along with him. He invited Timothy to come along with him on his missionary journeys. Come with me. Just spend time with me. Let me spend time with you. And Paul began to build into Timothy. And over the course of time, Timothy went from being someone who was just tagging along with Paul to someone who was actually helping Paul, to becoming a missionary himself, to someone who helped spread the gospel and spread the word. And he became a partner with Paul and an assistant. From Paul's time spent with him, he grew Timothy up to this point. In fact, if you follow Timothy's life, you find out he went beyond that. That Timothy, after he was with Paul in this time of imprisonment, and Paul was released, and they went on another ministry journey, Paul ended up leaving Timothy at Ephesus to be the pastor in the church that they formed there, while Paul went on. So Timothy must have come to a point where he was really trusted by Paul, where he was very capable, where he had leadership and teaching abilities that allowed him to stay and organize the church and teach it and pastor it, and Paul moved on. So in a quick summary, what happened with Paul's time with Timothy is he took this young man who had some potential, and he spent time with him. He invited him into his life, and he brought him along and raised him up to the point where he could work with Paul, but even past that point, to where Paul could leave him in charge of something. And this was a mutually encouraging relationship. Clearly, Paul was building it to Timothy and raising him up. But Paul also says, I want to send you Timothy. He's like my heart. I have no one like him. When Paul is thinking about who's the best person I can send, who knows me best, who can represent me well, he thinks of Timothy. I have no one like him. He's like a son to me, and I'm like a father. That was their relationship, and as Paul raised him up. But what I think is really interesting as I think about Paul and Timothy is that when Timothy and Paul crossed paths, Timothy was already a follower of Christ. Paul didn't lead Timothy to Christ. Timothy came to Christ another way. And you may or may not know how that all began, so I'm going to flip you to the book of 2 Timothy so you can see where that came from. So keep your finger in Philippians. Flip toward the back of the Bible. You're going to go through Colossians, 1 Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians, 1 Timothy. And when you get to 2 Timothy, we're going to look at the first chapter. In this Bible, it's page 963. This is Paul writing a letter to Timothy. It's actually his second letter to Timothy, while Timothy is leading the church in Ephesus. And Paul writes a couple times to Timothy to encourage him and to spur him on. Paul continues to build into Timothy's life, even though they're separated by distance. And this is one of the things that he says in here. In verse 5, Paul writes to Timothy, he says, I am reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you. What Paul is saying here is faith was passed down your family line from your grandmother to your mother, and now I know that you have faith too. I see it. And I think it's very cool when faith gets passed down through a family line. I look at Heidi's family, and you can trace back generations on both sides, her mother's side and her father's side. You can trace faith back for generations and generations and see how from one generation to the next, faith was passed on, the Lord was lifted up, and the torch of faith was carried forward from generation to generation, and you can trace it backwards. That's not true in my family. Jesus broke into my family with me and my siblings. You can't really trace faith back in the generations in the Joy family. A little spotty. My grandmother came to faith late in life. I'm not sure there are any others in my family tree. But going forward now, if we look forward, we can now trace faith from generation to generation, from child to grandchild. And I know that will continue because Jesus broke into the Joy family line and completely changed the trajectory of it so that where there was no history of faith, now there is. And one of the things we're discovering at this point in our life, Heidi and I, is that while it's a key role for parents to pass on faith to their children, there's a vital role that grandparents play in encouraging their children as they parent and in the lives of their grandchildren. We're seeing this now. And it is just, it's an amazing, wonderful gift of God to be able to pass faith down from, like in Timothy's case, grandmother to mother to son, and to see what Timothy's life did and how many people it touched. So I want to encourage us as we think about this, to think about who in your life you can be building into, you can be spending time with, you can come alongside and grow up. Because this isn't just about biological parenting or grandparenting. There's a need for spiritual fathers and mothers and brothers and sisters and friends. There's a big need for us in the relationships we have with each other to spend time with each other and come alongside someone and help raise them up. So I still have a lot more to share, but I want this thought to take root in your mind as I'm sharing. I want it to grab hold. And at one place while you're listening to me, there's another place where you're thinking, who is this person in my life that I can invest in, I can build into, I can spend time with? Because we can all do it and have a huge impact in the life of other people, especially younger people. I've always had a heart for trying to raise up someone younger, someone who may not be as far along in the faith as I am, and there are people farther along than me. We're all on a journey. But it's always my desire to try to figure out how I can help people to come along and even go beyond me. And doing it by spending time. You might think, well, I don't know that much Bible. I've never been to seminary or Bible college. I don't know that I have that much to offer. You absolutely do. You have your life and your ears and your interest and your prayers to invest in someone else. We were reminded of this, how this works just recently. Our oldest son turned 35 not too long ago. It was last Sunday. It seems like a long time ago. It was last Sunday. Heidi dragged out from storage a bin of things that she had saved over time, a lot of pictures that we'd taken. And this is the old-fashioned kind of picture that you actually can pick up and hold in your hand and slide into a photo album. We have a bin of pictures of our son through the years. And it was a great trip down memory lane and going through all those pictures. But looking at the pictures, we started to see again, and we were reminded of the people who spent time in our son's life. And then it really hit home when Heidi pulled out an envelope, a big manila envelope, that was stuffed with letters that people had written to our son Sam when he was getting ready to go off to college. I think Heidi had the idea. She gave an invitation to everyone, just write a letter of encouragement to our son Sam and we'll send them with him to college. And she saved them. And we read back through those. And in that pile, of course, there was one from me and one from Heidi and brothers and sisters and cousins and relatives. But in that pile were letters from a couple of men in church who were young men at the time, who had spent time with our son, who had taken him out for a hamburger to ask how life was going, shot baskets with him, did all kinds of things, just spending time with him and building into his life. And it reminded me of the impact a person can have on a younger person just by spending time with them. I was thinking about this again because my youngest son, Russ, was sharing with me a while back. This was pre-COVID, so it had to be a little more than a year ago. He's a youth pastor in the church he's in. And there were an older man in the church came to him and said, you know, we have a Bible study of men in the church, and I can't get any of the younger guys to come to, guys like your age in their 20s and 30. We can't get them to come to our Bible study. What could I do? How can I get them to come to my Bible study? We really would like to engage with some of the younger men. And I thought what my son answered was really profound. He said, well, you own a boat, don't you? And he said, yeah, I own a boat. He said, why don't you invite a couple of the younger guys out on your boat with you? Spend a little time out on the water, build a relationship with them, get to know them, spend some time with them, and then I bet if you invited them to your Bible study, they would come. And the man did it, and it worked brilliantly, because the basis of discipleship is the official term we call it. The basis of building into someone else comes from relationship. It really is spending time with people and getting to know each other. And just saying like this, you matter to me so much that I'm going to spend a little time with you, and I'm just going to ask you how life is going, ask you how I can pray, and to listen. Heidi and I were just talking again this week of how we're learning all over again the value of just listening to someone, because people don't get listened to, and what a powerful gift it is to just sit and listen to someone who wants to share something going on in their life. And we always feel a little bit compelled to, oh, we have to come up with an answer or a response. If someone's sharing a concern or a problem with us, I had someone just 2 days ago share something that was on her heart this past week. And I sat and listened to the whole thing, and the whole time I'm thinking, what do I say? What do I say? What do I say? What do I say, God? And then by the end of it, I realized I don't have to say anything. She just needed someone to listen to her. So to come into another person's life, just to be there and value them and affirm them and listen to them is a great way to help grow them in their faith and in their life. We have a couple friends who are so good at this. We have a friend named Kevin. He's a single guy. He's about my age, never married, and he has spent so much of his adult life just investing in other people, younger people, younger guys. Kevin loves to fish. And Kevin, over the years, I've seen him do this over and over and over, and he did it with both our boys. He just called him, hey, you want to go fishing with me? I got all the stuff. Just come, pick him up, go out and fish. And Kevin's not a big talker, so I pictured this fishing time as no talking. They just fished. And Kevin built relationship that way. And maybe he talked a little. Maybe he did a lot of listening. Maybe all he did was say, how's it going? And let the other guy talk. And I've watched Kevin's impact on so many lives just by spending time with them and just by showing an interest and just by a little bit of investment. I've said to Kevin more than once, someday in heaven, there's going to be a long line of people and they're going to have to take numbers. There are going to be so many of them. And they're all just lining up to thank you, Kevin, for what you did in their life and the time you took and spent with them, invested in them, growing them up. That's, I think, what Paul did with Timothy. I think he just spent time with him. He said, come along with me. Let's be friends. Let's spend time together. And through that relationship, Timothy did great things for the kingdom of God. Paul did the same thing with a man named Epaphroditus. Let's go back to Philippians 2. Where we left off was, I read verse 24 and I stopped there. I want to pick up in verse 25. I'm back on page 952 in the Church Bible. I'm going to read from verse 25 to verse 30. Paul continues, he says, but I think it's necessary to send back to you Epaphroditus, my brother, co-worker, and fellow soldier, who is also your messenger, whom you sent to take care of my needs. Now, I'll read the rest of this, but I just want to explain what that means. The Philippian church had sent money to Paul to help him, because when you're arrested like Paul was, under house arrest, you couldn't go out. You couldn't hold a job. You had to stay inside the house. You had a guard on you 24/7. You were free to roam around inside the house, but you couldn't leave. But you also had to pay for the house. You had to pay the rent. You had to buy food. I don't know how they expected people to be able to pay for their own house arrest when they couldn't go out and earn money to pay for that. So anyone under house arrest was dependent on other people, relatives or friends who would contribute to that, so they could pay for those needs. So the Philippian church is sending a gift of money to Paul, and they wanted to send it with someone they trusted who wasn't going to take the money and take off. So they put it in the hands of a young man named Epaphroditus, who was part of the Philippian church. And they said, please bring this to Paul. He journeyed on foot with what historians believe was a sizable sum of money, and he brought it to Paul as a gift from the church. So Paul is saying here, your messenger, your man that you sent to me, I want to send him back to you. It's almost like Paul's processing his thoughts. He says, I really want to come to you, but I don't know how long I'll be under house arrest. So maybe I'll send Timothy to you, but I don't know how quickly I can get him there. Oh, I know. I could send Epaphroditus back to you right now, the man you sent to me. That's what Paul's saying in this opening line. So he's saying, I think it's necessary to send back to you Epaphroditus, my brother, co-worker, fellow soldier, who is also your messenger, whom you sent to take care of my needs. For he longs for all of you and is distressed because you heard he was ill. Indeed, he was ill and almost died, but God had mercy on him, and not only on him, but also on me, to spare me sorrow upon sorrow. Therefore, I am all the more eager to send him, so that when you see him again, you may be glad and I may have less anxiety. So then, welcome him in the Lord with great joy and honor people like him, because he almost died for the work of Christ. He risked his life to make up for the help you yourselves could not give me. So what's referred to there is another relationship with Paul that was very much like Paul and Timothy. The Philippian church sent this young man, Epaphroditus, to Paul with money. And Paul must have seen something in him and kept him there, and they spent time together. And Epaphroditus started to help Paul. He started to become an assistant to him. And then he grew up from his time with Paul, and he became a leader. and he became a missionary. He actually got sent back to the Philippian church, and many commentaries believe he pastored the church for a while, and history has shown that he became a bishop in the vicinity, in Philippi. So he went from being a messenger boy, after spending time with Paul and being encouraged and built into and grown up, he went on to be a pastor and a bishop because Paul invested in him. And this was a two-way street, this relationship, because Paul is also saying here, he took care of me. You know what Paul is saying in these lines? It almost breaks my heart to send him back to you because he's so dear to me. But I know it will be so good for him to come back to you, and it'll be good for you too. So I want to send him. These are two examples of really healthy, incredible relationships where encouragement is passed on and people are lifted up and they get better because of it. They get bigger and stronger and more capable because of an encouraging relationship. Paul did the same thing with Titus. We're not going to look at that one today, but there's another New Testament letter from Paul to Titus. Titus was a young man. Paul saw some potential in him and spent time with him and raised him up, and he became a pastor of the church in Crete. Jesus did the same thing. Jesus taught the multitudes. He fed thousands. He commissioned 75 to send them out as missionaries. He spent his every day with 12 men. But he had special focus time with three, Peter, James, and John, that he really invested in. Jesus did the same thing. He said, come along with me. Walk with me. Do life with me. Let's spend time together. And out of that time, he grew people up to be disciples and followers. We have the ability to do the same thing. Just as you are, don't think that you need to know more, or you need a degree, or you need to be an official Christian, or a titled worker for the church. It's for all of us to have these kinds of relationships. It means the world to a young person when an older person takes some interest in them and says, how's life? I know it's harder with COVID, but hey, let's spend a little time together and just tell me how things are going. How's school? How are your relationships? How's life? How's life at home? To value and affirm and spend time with younger people. And I know many of you do it. I know some of the stories. And I just want to encourage you to continue doing it. And if not, I still want you to be thinking. Stop right now, because I wanted to just put a bookmark in your mind before. I hope it's still there. To be thinking, this is a person in my life that I could invest a little bit more time in. I can send a letter to, or an email, or invite out for a walk, or go to one of their games. You know, I mentioned my friend Kevin. One of the things he does like crazy, at least he did up until COVID, he went to kids' games. He was always seen on the sidelines or in the bleachers or just there watching the games. I heard from so many kids who said what it meant to them that they could look up in the stands and Kevin was always there. Those are the kinds of things we can offer, and they go so far. So who are you building into in your life? Who are you helping along? Who are you trying to raise up? Who are you speaking words of encouragement to? Who are you speaking words of life to? Who are you helping along in their journey? Is there someone like that in your life that you're already currently doing that with? Or is there someone like that in your life that you could do that with and start up a little bit of a relationship like that? Maintaining a healthy relational life requires paying attention to energy flow. What I'm asking you to do is think about someone that you can put energy into, relational energy going out from you toward them. But to stay in a relationally healthy spot, we need to also have relational energy coming back toward us. So I would add the additional question, do you have anybody who encourages you, who builds into you, who when you're with, and it could just be a good friend, when you're with them, you go away feeling a little bit more full? Because we all have people in our life relationally, that when we leave them, we feel a little more empty, right? It drains us a little bit. We also need to have people in our life. When we're with them, it fills us back up. I want to show you this really intricate, elaborate picture that I brought. If I can make my clicker work. We there? No? Oh, it's a beautiful picture. There it is. It's a jar. Who said that? Nice job. You recognized it. That makes me feel good. It's an empty jar at the moment. This jar, you could say, is like a reservoir. It's like a tank. And I want it to represent your level of relational reserves. So you could, at any time in your life, you could picture this jar and say, how full or empty am I relationally? And you know what I mean by that? Like, when you're full of relational energy, you feel like, hey, I'm ready to get together with people and interact. But when you're low, when you're drained out, you feel like, ugh, I got to go out and we're supposed to go to dinner tonight and I just don't have it in me. And your relational energy is low. So you could, at any point, you could draw a line across that jar and say, here's where I am today relationally. I'm empty, I'm full, I'm somewhere in between. The level of relational energy that you have in your life is dependent upon how much is coming in and how much is going out. So if you could imagine a little hole on the bottom of that jar, and these are the relationships that take some energy from you and drain some energy out, the level will go down. Now, your level only stays up if you also have people in your life who are putting into you that help keep that level up. Because you're going to have both. You're going to have relational energy that goes out and relational energy that goes in. So one of the things to think about when you're thinking about your relationship, not just is there someone I can build into, but are there people who fill my tank too? And I'm going to bring out a little bit of a tangent here. And I'll just tell you it's a tangent right away, and we'll come back to this. One of the things, tools that Heidi and I use when we talk with we counsel or we talk with couples, we've taught this in workshops and classes, is to pay attention to your energy reservoirs. That should have stayed up there. Did I do that? Nope. Here we go. That one? Yeah. Okay. You actually, if you take a look at your whole self, you are a spiritual, an emotional, a relational, and a physical being. And you have energy reserves in each of those four tanks. You can call them buckets or wells or reservoirs or jars or whatever. You have spiritual energy, you have emotional energy, you have relational energy, and you have physical energy. And you can, at any point in your life, put a mark on those jars to show where you are. The easiest one, I think, for us to think about or relate to is physical. It's like, ugh, I'm exhausted, I'm so physically tired, I just want to put my feet up, I want to go to sleep. I have no energy to take on any tasks. You might put your line near the bottom of that jar and say, I'm feeling kind of empty. Or you might say, I'm energized, I'm rested, I'm kind of ready to go. You might put your line more toward the top. But at any point in your life, you could say, here's where I am with my physical energy. Or I mentioned relational, I'm going to skip that. Or spiritual, like I'm feeling just so spiritually full. Or I'm just feeling so spiritually empty. And as we go through these things with people, we always ask, what are the things that fill that jar? And what are the things that empty it? What are the spiritual activities that fill you up? What are the spiritual activities that drain you down? And what we find when we have conversations with people is people can understand and relate to the physical one, the spiritual one, the relational one, because we're in relationships. But the one that always gets overlooked is the emotional one. It's always sort of in the background, but we have emotional reserves. And this tank, when this tank is low, that's when it's hard to get out of bed. That's when it's hard to say, I got to do another day. I just don't have the energy reserves to meet the needs of my day. When that one's full, that's when we feel like, yeah, I can meet the needs of my day. That one gets drained out. That one gets filled, just like all the rest of the tanks. And when that one's low, all of these affect each other, but when that one's low, it's like a red line. It's like a flag going up. And one of the reasons for that, for those of us who call us Christians, is we tend to ignore that one and make everything fit the spiritual jar. When we're feeling like, oh, I just don't have the energy to meet the needs of the day, we spiritualize that and say, I just need to pray more. I just need to spend more time with God. I should memorize more scriptures, or I should get into a Bible study, or I should do more spiritual activities. And those things are all good, but it's almost like we're addressing the wrong symptoms because our emotional energies are low and we're trying to fix it with spiritual activities. I know I brought you on a little bit of a tangent. I just wanted to give you a smattering of that. If you're more interested in that, let me know. We can talk more about that. But I wanted you to see that's where this relational tank came from. So you are a relational being. The Bible says that we have a spirit and soul, and we're wrapped up in a physical body. but we're also in relationship with each other. So as you think about relationships, I would like you to think about what relationships fill you and what relationships drain you, because I don't want to just send you out with the encouragement to go build into someone else if you're empty. I want you to gauge on where you are, and I want you to start thinking about the people that you can pour into, but also who in my life pours into me, so that you can stay in a healthy relational balance. So this is what I'd like you to do, and you can do it at home. I would like you to get out a piece of paper and a pen or a pencil and draw yourself a container. It doesn't have to be a jar. It could be a bucket, could be a bowl, could be a glass, could be a vase, any kind of container you want. And if you're not up for that, email me and I'll send you a picture of mine and you can print that out. And I want you to just ask yourself, give yourself a few minutes, ask yourself, where would I draw the level? Where would I draw the line on this? In my relational life, as I relate to other people, where would I put the line today? And it could change a week from now, might have been different months ago, but today, I'm half full, I'm really full, I'm kind of low. Take just a minute or two, sometime today or this week, and say, how full am I relationally? And then ask yourself, why is that? Why, if you're down really low, why am I down really low? If I'm filled, why am I filled? And then ask yourself, who in my life, in my relationship, does it take energy for me to be in that relationship? Now, I'm not talking about toxic relationships that you should get out of. I'm just talking about day-to-day relationships. There are always relationships that take energy from you. And just write that down. These are the people that when I'm with them, it's really me more giving. And then think about who are the people in my life that when I'm with, I come away and I feel like I just got topped off. I just got a little filled up. I'm a little more energized. And you may have one or two people like that, maybe three. Write their names down too, right on the piece of paper. And give yourself this snapshot. It's a snapshot of this moment in time when you're filling it out. That just a gauge on how full am I relationally and how balanced am I relationally. And that'll be a healthy picture for you. It'll be a good thing to do to come away and say, I'm really happy with this snapshot I just took, or I think I need to make some adjustments here. I need to find another relationship that fills me more, or I have too many relationships that are just requiring way too much energy, and that's why I feel empty all the time. And it'll be a different answer for every one of us. Within that, as you assess your snapshot, I want to go back to my encouragement from this passage today. Every one of us, when we draw a picture like that, should be able to have a name or two in there where we say, this is a person who benefits from our relationship, who I'm building into, who I can encourage, who I can just help take their next step. So as we wrap up, I'm going to leave you to think about that prayerfully. I'm going to leave you to, in your mind, just say, Lord God, help me to think about the relationships in my life. Who do I build into? Who builds into me? How healthy am I? How balanced? How full? And what could I take for a next step? And then even just more generally, can I be a person who just puts more intentionality into speaking words of life and words of encouragement into the lives of other people? So as we think about that in prayer before God, I'm going to call the band back up because in a moment they're going to close our service with a song. And so we know that God fills us, as you're thinking and praying and meditating before God. God fills us. We can love other people because God loves us first. We can be in relationship because God's in relationship with us. We have energy to expend to other people because God gives us energy. Let's just loop that back around and say it all begins with God. We love because He loved us. And we're in relationship with each other because He loved us. Jesus said, and we sang a song about this earlier today, that people will know my disciples by their love, how they love each other. And so we're able to love each other for one reason, because He loved us first. So let's go full circle, bring our time to a close with this song that lifts up the name of our God.
Thank you, Joel. Please rise.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my side. Angels descending, ringing my bell, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I am my Savior, and happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. My story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. Story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is
Galatians chapter 5, verse 13, you, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge in the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. Thank you, everyone, for joining us this morning. Go in peace, have a blessed week, and may you have a ball serving. Thank you.